My name is Ali Kujuri. I'm an adjunct professor at this department, at the engineering science department, and also one of the basically one of the guys who arranges this lecture series on behalf of our department and the engineering and the School of Science and Technology. I would like to welcome you all to this ninth talk in the series. Also, my thanks go to Agilent Technologies for supporting this lecture series since the start in 2000 and fall 2006. Before I introduce our speaker for today, let me mention that for 2 weeks from now, on the 15th of March, we have Dr. Lily Chen, a professor, biology professor at the in San Francisco State University, and her talk is titled "Emerging Trend in Engaging Engineering Tools to Biological Research." Those of you, some of you already know that we had another speaker for today. The original speaker, Dr. Patrick Pfeffer from Juniper. In fact, just about a week ago, sent me an email. Oh, I'm sorry, I would not be able to make it because I must go to Europe, and I cannot be there. So as soon as I just started to go around and then find a good speaker, then I in fact contacted Solmetric. In fact, Peter generously basically offered to come and give us a talk. So our department is very, really thankful to accepting the invitation. Our guest speaker for today, Mr. Peter Hoberg, will be talking on an introduction to photometric energy production. Mr. Peter Hoberg has over 20 years experience in marketing and business development with Hewlett-Packard and Agilent Technologies, and now is a vice president of marketing for Solmetric Corporation. Solmetric is a leading manufacturer of test and measurement equipment for the solar energy based in Sebastopol, California, with focus on time-saving tools for the photovoltaic installation segments. He has had a variety of responsibilities, including product management, sales support, and support planning for test and measurement hardware and software solutions. More recently, he has business development manager. He was a business development manager at a small renewable energy company. Mr. Hoberg holds a green MBA degree from the New College of California and has a BS and Master of Science degree in electrical engineering from Stanford University. So here is Mr. Hoberg.
Thank you very much. And I thank you for having me. I'm very excited to be here. And even though I was not the first choice, you know, or the second, you know, I was pretty far down the list. But I really am excited to be here, and I'm happy to share. You know, I had a long time working with Hewlett-Packard and Agilent Technologies, and it was great. And then I got sort of the bug to try to do something in the renewable energy field. And so I ended up at Solmetric, and now I am have the opportunity to, among other things, sort of explore the markets, what's happening in the industry, and also how our products, existing products, can be applied to the industry, but also how we might be able to think about new products and how they might be applicable to emerging trends. So what I'm going to talk about today is mostly focused about solar, mostly focused about photovoltaic solutions for solar, But I welcome your inputs and questions about any other peripheral or related topics. Toward the end, I'm going to talk a little bit about how you might explore jobs in the field or related fields, and also how you can engage in the solar industry, you know, and learn more about it. So we won't have in the next 45 minutes or so, we won't have time to get into the details that you might not even know you'd want to learn about yet. But I'll hopefully set your give you some ideas on where you could go for additional information in the future. So how do we switch to? Okay, now I can. Okay, first of all, a quick introduction to Solmetric. I'm going to come back and talk about the products we make a little bit and sort of more or less what they do. But this is sort of a niche within the overall market. So I'm going to try to spend more time talking about the bigger picture stuff, a little less just about Solmetric. But Solmetric's interesting too. It's just that it's a piece. So we have three product areas. One is a shade measurement tool used for site evaluation. During the process of evaluating whether a home or business is good for a solar installation, you need to figure out whether the sun's going to shine in the place where you want the system to be. So what we do is we have a little piece of equipment that takes a fisheye camera picture of the sky and then figures out how the sun paths fit on that and where you're going to get shade and how much the shade's going to impact your energy production. So that's the short story there. I'll show you that more later. Then we have a software tool. You know, products in this market are very much both hardware and software. We have a software tool that takes this data and helps you do a design of a photovoltaic system, putting modules on a roof that are sized from a database and putting them in the right strings and calculating based on the weather and based on the specifications how much energy you're going to get over the course of a month or a year. So that's a very important piece of information that the installer community needs to know when they're designing systems. And lastly, we have an electrical piece of test equipment, which is more along the lines of what Hewlett-Packard and Agilent Technologies do more frequently. And it's a piece of equipment that hooks up to the wires of a photovoltaic system after it's installed to check it out during the commissioning process and make sure that it's operating properly. So that mission statement is sort of corporate mumbo-jumbo there, so we can skip that. These are some of the topics that I'm going to go through. First, I'm going to talk about sort of the worldwide market for solar and get into how PV works and what PV systems look like and what are some of the oddball kinds of PV that you read a lot about and where they stand in the market. Then we'll talk about some of the trends looking forward and, you know, where to go if you're interested in more information. So this is a representation of the insolation. Now, if you look in a dictionary, usually insolation is not a word that's in the dictionary, but what it means is incident solar radiation. And what it is a measure of energy. And it's the amount of power through time that, so irradiance is power. So if you look at how much power strikes the Earth over a square meter, if you look in the outer atmosphere, it's like, I don't know, 1,300, 1,500 watts per meter squared or something like that. By the time you get to the surface of the Earth, typically it's around 1,000 watts per meter squared. If you had that over an hour, you know, a square meter over an hour, you'd get a kilowatt hour, you'd get 1,000 watt hours per meter squared, or a kilowatt per meter squared. That's the incident solar radiation, insolation. So if you look over the course of a year and then you make these fancy color graphs, what you see is some kind of chart like this, where the orange, the darker orange or reddish colors are where you get more insolation over the course of a year. And where there are lighter colors, you get less insolation over the course of a year. So who can give me a few ideas on what would cause insolation to vary as it does here? Any ideas?
Latitude, cloud cover.
Latitude?
Remember, the Earth is tilted, and as it goes around the sun, you get the seasons. And if you're at the equator, basically it balances out, so you're probably going to get more at the equator. Cloud cover, where you have a lot of clouds, you're not going to get as much. What else?
Humidity, mountains, you know, various other factors. The amount of rainfall is typically opposite that. So what else happens in places where there's a lot of sunshine is it can get really hot. And that's not necessarily good for all solar systems. If you're trying to heat water, that's probably good, but if you're trying to run a nice photovoltaic system, it might not be so good. So anyway, there's lots of solar resource. This is the solar resource available. If you look at the overall solar resource hitting the Earth over the course of 1 hour, that'd be enough power or enough energy to meet the world's energy needs for a whole year. So if we could just grab it. So we can't do that, but we can certainly help. And so what's happening more and more is places in the world are starting to try to take advantage of this resource more and more. Here's what the solar resource looks like more in the United States. And so there's a few things for comparison here. You can see this is exaggerated, the atmosphere. Anybody know the official definition of space is 120 miles up? So the atmosphere is 120 miles. If you look over how that compares to the Earth in terms of size, the atmosphere is about like an eggshell on an egg, okay, in terms of thickness. So, but the thickness, if you look at it at an angle, is going to be a lot more. And so that's why you have to go through more atmosphere, and you're going to end up with less available sunshine when you're at the generally at the higher latitudes. Remember, latitude is zero at the equator and 90 degrees up at the North Pole. So when you have less humidity, less cloud cover, less weather, less vegetation, you tend to have a lot more insulation. And you have there are various terms for this, but GHI is global horizontal radiation. It includes both direct radiation, which is basically, if you're looking at the sun, exactly what's coming directly from the sun, versus diffuse radiation, which comes from clouds, from reflected off of everything. So a combination of direct normal and diffuse radiation is global horizontal radiation, and that's generally what's plotted on these things. You can see the darkest blue is a 1,000 watts per meter squared, kilowatt hours per meter squared per year, kilowatt hours per meter squared per year. And the deepest, darkest red is about 2,500 kilowatt hours per meter squared per year. So one of the reference points here is Alaska, which looks pretty dismal from a solar perspective. And so does that other country there, Germany. So just looking at this, where do you suppose the largest worldwide market for solar energy is? What? Alaska? It's Germany. Why? I don't know. I was hoping somebody could tell me.
Well, I think it's the government there.
There's a lot of incentives and a lot of desire to go green there and a lot of desire to create a new industry, a new market, and then ultimately to export it. And so what's happening there is a new market. So I'm just going to show you some slides on that might be interesting about where solar is being installed. So this is by year, starting in 2004 through last year, where solar energy is getting installed around the world. And this is the installations during each year. So it's not the cumulative. This is every year more and more is being produced and more is being installed. So it's hard to see all the colors because there's a lot of them, but a couple of things stand out. There are some markets that are really good and that are sustainable and lasting a long time. Okay, one of those is Germany. Germany is the one at the bottom, it's the blue. And it's been a very sustainable, strong market. And they set a record in 2010 with About 5 gigawatts of seven gigawatts of installed capacity in 2010. Then 2011, it came down a little bit. And then this other green country kicked in and set a new record. That's a new record. 2011, the record was set by Italy. There's a lot more sunshine in Italy, but this is just in how many panels are produced or how many kilowatts peak of DC. So that doesn't necessarily relate to how many kilowatt hours, just how many panels. So some of these markets are sustainable and last a long time. We'll see what happens in Italy in the future. But one notable example from the past is Spain. That's that red one there. They had a banner year, the leading world market in 2008. In 2009, I think it was like number 12 or something. So, you know, the government policies are very important in determining how these things get implemented, and the Germans have done a much better job than the Spanish did. We'll see if the Italian ones work out. The U.S. market is this purple one right here above the, that's France. This is the U.S. It's this upper purple one. And so it's a small market. Last year, the U.S. was something like 7% of the total worldwide installations. What's up with that? We're like 25% of the world's GDP, and we've only, what's up with that? Why is that? Well, you could argue that the U.S. kind of went early and tried to do a bunch of things. We had, you know, the 70s and the 80s, and a lot of people got burned by sort of unsustainable policies, and it was a difficult time. Solar got a bad name. People weren't going to do that again. So we're trying to establish this as a sustainable market, and everybody is sort of betting that the U.S. is going to be the world's largest solar market soon. That U.S. and China are going to be the largest solar markets. So, but they're not now, currently. China had a good year last year with almost 2 gigawatts installed. So that's always how you measure the number the amount of activity is and how many gigawatts or megawatts or kilowatts get installed. And that's just the number of panels, not necessarily how much gets generated. If you look at 2011, this was actually shows cumulative how much is installed in the world. And there are currently about 67 gigawatts installed. Well, that can generate on an annual basis about 80 billion kilowatt hours per year, which can fuel about 20 million households. That's worldwide, the solar market. So how much, anybody know how many households there are in the United States? About 115 million. So you could say that the solar energy market has not really gotten very far yet. That's why a lot of us are really excited about the future of solar, because there's so much opportunity still out there. And there was a really interesting report just released recently from the Sunshot Initiative, which is a Department of Energy program, and it's called the Sunshot Vision Program. And they say that by 2020, if the U.S. is very aggressive, we could generate up to 14% of our electricity from solar. And currently, it's less than 1%. So that's an exciting possibility. But also, you could see that this is the European Union here, which is the 20-some countries of Europe, are 75% of the overall market. And last year, in 2011, they were 75% of the new installations were in Europe. 60% of the overall market was in Germany and Italy only. So these countries are Italy last year installed about 6 times as much solar as the photovoltaic as the United States does. Italy, come on, it's just a little country. So there's a lot of room to grow, and a lot of resource we can take advantage of. This is an older slide from 2009, but it shows that we use a heck of a lot of energy from a U.S. point of view, and that renewable energy is a small portion, and of that, solar is a small sliver. So again, we have a long way to go. This shows the U.S. market by size or by segment. Now, never mind that box for a minute. These boxes show the residential solar installations, which we're probably more familiar with, right? See it on the neighbor's house, or maybe you have it on your house. Then there's a commercial market, which is, you know, getting a little bigger, like you see it on the, you know, Walgreens or Walmart, or, you know, where people are installing hundreds of kilowatts peak, or even a megawatt, like a Walmart, if you plastered the whole Walmart with solar PV, you'd get about a megawatt of peak power. And then there's the utility scale, which is usually ground mounted on poles that come out of the ground, and that's where you have, you know, acres and acres of PV planted in the ground instead of crops. And that's becoming more and more important, driven largely in the U.S. by the Renewable Portfolio Standard, RPS, which is a state-specific program. So, for example, in California, there's a rule that the investor-owned utilities have to have a certain percentage of their portfolio come from renewable sources by 2020. And anybody know the number? I think it's 20% by, maybe it's 30% by 2020. Anyway, there's percentages that, and that's a state-specific mandate. There's a lot of people saying we should do something at the federal level, which could be nice, but that's probably not going to happen anytime between now and the election anyway. Some of the numbers for solar in the U.S., about 4 gigawatts, about 5 billion kilowatt hours per year, a small sliver of the overall electrical requirements, enough for 500,000 households, so we still got a lot more households to go. And just as a data point, there are about 6 billion square meters of rooftop space in the U.S., and so there's just lots of opportunity. That's only a very small slice of that is covered with solar. So this is the U.S., this is a summary. I have that. Overall, last year, about 1.7 megawatts were installed. Cumulative, 5.8 gigawatts. That's if you add up all the years through 2011. There's about 200,000 installations if you add up all the homes and businesses with solar, and about almost 7 billion kilowatt hours can be generated. So we still got a long way to go for that. So hopefully from all that you say, okay, there's some opportunity here. Meanwhile, a very important trend has happened in the industry as well, which is the costs of solar are coming down dramatically over time. And this shows a chart from 1985 through 2011. There's a little bump in the increase, but this is just the solar module price. Okay? And it turns out that solar panels or solar modules are suddenly not the only thing to worry about. It used to be that they would dominate the expense. Now, if you look at Shift, Control, Delete. Yeah, just go back. Thank you. So this is the cost of the in residential. We'll just focus on this one for now. But this is the cost of the module. Notice there's lots of other costs. Some of that is for the inverter, which is how you get from a DC signal to a AC signal, which you can connect up to the grid. But that's not even that much. This is installation materials, all the racking and stuff you have to, you know, plumbing and hardware and conduit and wires and all that stuff. And then this one is installation labor. Oh yeah, you got to pay the people to put them on the roof. And this is Permitting, oh yeah, you got to make sure the city of Santa Rosa is happy when you put your thing on the roof. And this big one up here is overhead and profit. It's not that much profit really, but it all adds up. And you can see that the module prices have really become lower and lower. And you know, there's people selling for $1 a watt now. This usually, you talk about $1 a watt, or if you have a kilowatt, that's going to be $1,000 a kilowatt for the panels only. You know, typically a 5 kilowatt system might cost $5 per watt, which would be about $25,000. So that's gross cost, and then you might have incentives and things too. But anyway, main idea is the costs have come down, but there's still a lot of work to do, not only on those poor module manufacturers, but in the whole life cycle to continue to make it competitive. There are some areas of the United States where the solar electricity has become competitive with the fossil fuel-based electricity, such as in Hawaii. Anybody know why it's competitive in Hawaii? Because they don't really have the fossil fuels there, so they have to import them, and so the cost is very high. So, okay, a quick background on PV. If you want to tie to the grid, you need to generate some electricity with some DC. You might have those in series. Put those into an inverter, have some way of getting the AC signal into the house so you can offset the load from the house, turn on the lights in the house or whatever, and then you have a meter, which is typically manages this whole process where you can export excess energy to the grid. So, by the way, people often ask, well, what happens if the power goes out? Can I use my solar system? And the answer is usually no, unless you have some really special hardware. But the reason the answer is no is because in the event of a power outage, you can't put any signals onto the grid. And so the system is basically shut down and is not generating anything. And the reason is for the safety of the linemen who might be doing repair work on the systems. That there are solutions to that, but it's not currently normal to do that. So the answer is usually no.
And the meter is bidirectional, I suppose.
The meter is bidirectional. If you have a solar system on your house, you can go out, and if you're generating and not using anything in the house, you'll see it spin backwards. If you're using a whole lot in the house and it's the middle of the night, you'll see it spinning forwards like it normally does. And if you're just using the same amount that you're generating, it won't move at all. So that's the way that the bidirectional meters work. Some of the terminology you might be familiar with, you have cells. Cells go into modules. You might have, typically you have a 72 or 94 cells in a module, and then the modules go into strings or arrays, and you build up into a larger and larger system.
What size is the cell?
4 inches? 4 inches. I don't know the exact dimensions, okay. But typically it would be about 4 inches. They vary. But the modules themselves are, I was going to bring one, but it's kind of hard to. They're about 5 feet tall and 3 feet wide, two and a half feet wide. So they're big enough, they're small enough so that people can reasonably hoist them up to their buddy on the ladder, and the buddy on the ladder can hoist it up to the next person. There's procedures for doing that, by the way. But so typically everything scales. You know, you get the cells to modules to strings to arrays, and everything sort of scales up. But first, let's start down in the base level. You got sunlight, which is photons striking some sort of surface, and you want an anti-reflective surface. And there's all kinds of technology just in making this kind of glass so it won't reflect too much of the photon energy. So the photons come in and they interact with the substrates, which are doped semiconductors, and there's a PN junction basically in there for those of you who are studying electronics, and you end up creating whole electron pairs and a voltage which can turn into a current when connected to a load. Typically, everything's connected in series, or some number of them are connected in series, like batteries in a flashlight, and so we'll talk about that a little bit more. This shows the photon, which looks remarkably like a golf ball here, but it's a photon. And that's creating a charge by knocking free an electron. The charge has a path to get separated from its whole neighbor, whole without the W, and then get collected in the form of a circuit. And you get a whole bunch of these things in series, and so any one of them that isn't working properly can be a bottleneck, like the way we say it is like a kink in the garden hose. It will impede the flow of current throughout that string. Similar to if you have a bad battery in a flashlight, it can bring down the whole flashlight when you only have one bad battery. Typically, modules are connected in a string. If you have 72 cells in a module, 12 modules in a string, that would be 864 cells, all tied in series. Think of 864 batteries all tied together, each of them with a small voltage and generating a small current. There is an equivalent circuit for a solar cell, and it's basically a current source proportional to the energy striking it, those photons, or the number of photons, in parallel with a diode. That's the PN junction. So that has a curve that's a lot like a diode curve, which would normally look like this, something like 0.7 volts, and then it would have a breakdown region back here for anybody who's studying this. But because this is a source rather than a sink, you actually flip this over, and so instead of drawing it like that, you draw it like this. And then because it's a source that actually has a current generator inside it, it actually gets flipped over too. And then because it has a current generator inside it, and so that's the IV curve. So it might be more information than you need, but basically there's an IV curve. There's a characteristic of a cell. And when you have a number of cells in series, it's going to make a new IV curve, which is the combination of all those IV curves. And what you want to do is you want to find a point on there to operate, which is a good voltage and a good current to operate at. Where do you think that would be? What are you trying to maximize? Power. Why power? Well, that's where you get the kilowatts, right? That's where you turn the lights on. Power is current times voltage. So what you want to do is you want to take the current times the voltage. If you look at all the rectangles here, the one with the maximum area, maximum IV, is at the knee of the curve. So that's where the operating point is established using the inverter. The inverter is what establishes that operating point. So this shows that IV curve. You can also plot power, which is sometimes called the PV curve, and the max power point is what the inverter tries to find. Get the knee of that curve and you find the maximum power point. There's various max power current, max power here, max power. There's the open circuit voltage, which is where this curve goes over zero voltage. There's the short circuit current where there's no voltage, only current, et cetera. These are all things that are specified in a cell. When the silicon manufacturer might sell the cell with an S, the cell with a C, and then they'll specify the IV curve and the open circuit current, short circuit current, open circuit voltage, et cetera. And then the module manufacturers will do the same thing. But when you have a whole bunch of cells in series, they basically add up this way because they're stacking on the voltages. It's like those batteries in a flashlight. When you then put that circuit in parallel with something else, like you might put several strings of modules in parallel, you actually add it that way. And what you get when you do combinations of series and parallel is you get a composite IV curve, and it looks like that upper dotted line there. When you have things like shading or other impairments in the system, your IV curve can be dramatically impacted. Oh, let me go back to the, I can't go backwards with this. I probably can, I just don't know how. Go back to the healthy IV curve there for a moment. Yeah, that's fine. So one thing I want to point out is, remember we talked about irradiance? Irradiance basically is what sets the level of this plateau here. More irradiance makes more current. Less irradiance makes less current. Similarly, on the open circuit voltage, that's primarily determined by temperature. More temperature makes less voltage. Very good. a lower temperature make a higher voltage. So if you're operating, remember I mentioned at the start that if you're operating at very high temperatures, you can actually reduce the effective power generated and reduce the efficiency. So typically what you see in a hot climate, and you'll actually see this in, you know, Sonoma County, is during the day you'll get an increase as the irradiance comes up, and then it'll peak out, and then you'll get a little dip in the middle of the day when the temperature rises so high that you have a lot of irradiance but a lot of temperature, and you'll get a little dip in the peak of the daily curve there. Okay, so if you have shade, that can do bad things like that distorted curve. I'm not going to get too much into that. I'll talk a little bit more about it when I show you the Solmetric products later. Various things can affect PV array performance, as you might guess, and Solmetric can help measure them. So let's talk about what some of these look like. This is where I get into the sort of a lot of the pictures and things. So this is like a typical residential system. That's maybe 2 kilowatts peak, okay? And this one might be, I don't know, 100 kilowatts. So that's a typical good-sized commercial system. This is a good-sized residential system. This is almost to the utility scale here. This is a system in Oregon that's a better part of a megawatt. And these typically are strings of maybe a dozen modules, and they have to be sort of strung together, and you got to put those wires into some kind of a box that you can combine things. So they're called combiner boxes. These combiner boxes have fuses in them. There's actually a lot of power going into these things, so you need like big battery cable size things to get the current out. You might have 15 amps from each of the DC coming in from each of the strings. All that current is adding to these big ones that are going out to the inverter. So you have big, hairy DC signals going into your inverter and then becoming AC and getting connected up to the grid. So I'll come back to regular PV in a minute. There's another kind of PV which takes advantage of MJ. And that's not Michael Jackson. It's multi-junction cells, and also either lenses or mirrors. And what it does is it focuses energy into a different kind of circuit that's an advanced circuit. And this is a couple of pictures of examples of, see the lens, in this case it's a lens focusing energy, and typically you have In all of these cases, you have to put these in areas with high DNI. Anybody remember what DNI is? Direct normal irradiance? Because you need to focus that lens or those mirrors or whatever is going to collect the sunlight, because it's got to get oriented right on your high-tech multi-junction cells. And to do that, you have to track the sun, basically. So all these things are on trackers. So that causes a lot more mechanical difficulty. But the advantage is you get much higher efficiency and much better high temperature performance. So these are all examples of concentrating photovoltaic systems. And they're all on trackers. And this shows a little bit of that multi-junction. The advantage of multi-junction technologies are that if you just have a single junction, like that original circuit that I showed, which is typical for a flat plate, very cheap, if you have multi-junction, you can do more to capture the different wavelengths of light. If you know, the sunlight is very inconvenient and it has a really messed up spectrum, you know, and that's just the way that it is. And the photons come in at different energy levels. And so if you have just one type of junction, it's just going to capture the energy at that one type of energy level. But if you can have multi-junctions that are slightly different in their makeup, you can have different styles of catcher's mitts or whatever for each of the photons, and you can get much better efficiency from a multi-junction system. Yes?
Do you have any numbers on what it costs to make a multi-junction cell versus a single crystal silicon?
Not to make it, but to have it installed and operating and generating a kilowatt hour, it's very competitive.
Okay.
But you have, I tried to do it again. You have a host of challenges when you're doing a CPV system,
yeah.
Like getting those big structures into the ground, having the trackers, all that mechanical crud, all of that adds up so that the silicon cost becomes almost negligible to the overall system cost. But the overall cost is competitive in areas with DNI of 5.5 kilowatt hours per meter squared. So it's generally in the desert, it's going to cost less to generate a kilowatt hour.
Are these commercially available?
Yes.
Okay. Who makes them?
Well, there's those companies that were in the slides there, Concentrix and Sol Focus and Skyline Solar.
Okay.
These are companies that are making the end product. Who makes the silicon? They might have subcontractors doing that, but
sure.
That's part of their secret sauce.
Yeah.
Any idea what the efficiency of multi-junction versus silicon? Okay.
How about this? I just show this to confuse everybody, but this is an efficiency chart of different technologies through time, and you can see that the highest efficiencies are being done by space age space applications. These are some of the multi-junction are in the purple here, so they're pretty high tech. They're at the top, so if you look at, they're in the 40s. And these other ones down here are this is the green is the thin film, and this is the more standard crystalline silicon. I'm going to show you an easier chart in a second,
okay.
But as soon as you're done studying that,
we're good.
So by the way, that chart comes out of that sunshot vision study, which is great reading. It's about 100 pages long, but it is great reading. Sunshot Vision Study, it gives you a lot of background and paints a picture of a possible future for the U.S. solar energy. Now, this is interesting because on that previous chart, remember there was the red ones at the bottom? That's kind of lame, really low efficiency, like 10%. Who would want to use that? Well, these are the thin film. There's the multi-junction, that's the high efficiency. Thin film is low efficiency. Who needs low efficiency? Well, efficiency isn't necessarily all there is. What else might there be?
Cost.
Cost, right. So if you can just kind of stick your your substrate into a laser printer and out spits a photovoltaic, you know, that's pretty cool. And that's exactly what they're using. They're using printing techniques to make these at a very low cost. Plus, there are some characteristics that make thin film unique. In lower radiance, cadmium telluride is what CDTE is. CSI is crystalline silicon. Now, what this shows is the relative efficiency versus the irradiance. At high irradiance, they're about the same. If the sun's shining, everything's good. But what about if it's a cloudy environment? What about if you're trying to install solar in Belgium? By the way, Belgium's a pretty good solar market. Well, about the same size as California. What if you're trying to install in Belgium where there's lots of clouds all the time? Look how much better at lower radiance the cadmium telluride is. What about in the Mojave Desert? You want to do a low-cost system? Look at, this is cadmium telluride here. What we're plotting here is the temperature, temperature effect. As you get higher and higher temperatures, the cell temperature goes up. And as you get higher and higher temperatures, efficiency drops. But look how much less it drops for crystalline silicon versus SIGS, which is another copper, indium, gallium, diselenide, another thin film type of technology. So the bottom line there is efficiency is not the only thing. There's other things to talk about. Cost and performance in environments where you might want to stick your solar. And you know, no one technology is likely to win the whole race. You know, there's likely to continue to be places for each of these various technologies. Here's the chart that I was saying that I promised that is more simple. This shows efficiencies. And for each major technology, and I talked about some of these, I didn't talk about all of them, but for each major technology type, it shows what is currently sort of in production, what's the bleeding edge experimenter doing, the yellow is the what's sort of in production, the bleeding edge experimenters are the people doing the red ones, and what's hypothetically, theoretically, you know, possible is in the gray. And what I find interesting about this is if you look at crystalline silicon, what's theoretically possible, we're pretty close. We're going to eke out another couple of percent, but we're not going to, you know, like triple it. So there's only so much you can do. And we still have a long way to go with some of the more advanced technologies. So study your electronics, I guess that's what that's about. Again, that chart is in that same study. I'm going to spend only a minute on concentrating solar power, but this is another acronym. I talked about some of the three-letter acronyms. CPV was concentrating photovoltaic. That's where you focus in on a silicon, a chunk of silicon. This is where you boil a liquid, like usually water running through something. And it could be where you have all these things moving in, you know, so that they focus on one point in space and they heat the heck out of some liquid and then use that to have steam turn a turbine. And one of the advantages of that is once you get to the heat, you know, the industry's already invented lots of good turbine kind of products that can take steam and make it into power, right? But, you know, doing this is complicated and not for the average homeowner. This is another technology which is basically these troughs, and the troughs basically tilt on one axis to follow the sun, and they heat the heck out of liquid going down the pipe in the middle.
Is that water or anything?
Sorry?
Is that water or?
Water, yeah. Okay. Typically it's water. And one of the challenges, and there's lots of challenges with this. It's fascinating stuff. And in that study, it talks about the sunshot study. It talks about CSP, concentrating solar power, which is different from CPV. Don't mix those up. But it talks about that and PV market, and it talks about the challenges in each. But it does have CSP becoming a big part, like about 1/5 as big as the overall PV market. So we do have now a lot of systems operating, a couple of systems operating, and we're going to have a lot more. And these are like, you know, 100 megawatts, a couple hundred megawatts, as big as a nuclear power plant in terms of peak power that they can generate. One of the problems is, what do you do with all that power? If you have it, what do you do with it all at once? And so that's where they're talking about all kinds of advanced energy storage technologies, from, you know, batteries to compressed air to molten salt. Actually talking about boiling, you know, making liquid salt, which retains heat, and then you can feed that heat back into, heat the water up over time. So you can basically take the solar energy and spread it out over the course of a whole day. Fascinating stuff. This is a little bit of the charts, some of the that we use in our seminars. You know, this is how the sun goes over the course of a day. This is the winter solstice. This is the summer solstice. These are all the days in between. And this is the elevation of the angle of the sun relative to the horizon. This is the azimuth in degrees. 180 is south. You look south, and you know, when you're doing a solar evaluation, you can use one of our fancy things, or you can just look south and say, okay, it's going to come this way, and it's going to go from left to right over the course of a day. It'll do this in the winter, and it'll do this in the summer, and see what's blocking your view. Our equipment will take, I actually have one here. I'll just hand it around. This is a fisheye lens and a digital camera. And what you do is if you program it like your iPhone, and it takes a picture and shows you the sun paths from this point. So you go down from the point of the array, you take a picture, and it'll show you in green where the obstructions are, and it'll make calculations about how much energy you'll lose over the course of the day. This was our original model, and this is the new one. So I don't need to give you a sales pitch, but it's a pretty cool product, and it's sort of the base company. So how does shade affect a typical day's energy production? This actually shows various days during the course of a year for one of Solmetric friends' solar systems. And notice here that in the winter, frequently the sun is lower, and so you're going to get more more energy lost during the morning and afternoon hours. You can see that here with the edges getting cut off due to shading. Let's talk a little bit about measuring performance. We talked about IV curves. Well, you can measure an IV curve with a little current and voltage sensor. So we have a product to do that too. This is called the Solmetric PVA 600, a PV analyzer, and it basically sweeps the IV curve. So what it does is it has it replaces the load with a device that lets the charge from the solar array charge a battery in here. And as it charges the battery, we measure the current and voltage and basically switch out and discharge that battery. Because it's a lot of power, you want to get rid of it fast. And it does that all in about 100 milliseconds. So it's basically, I'm going to skip handing this one around, but I want to show you that this is the kind of user interface that I really like. There's one button, you just turn it on. And actually the user interface is on a PC, and it's controlled with a wireless interface on a personal computer. That's the example of holding that there. Oops. So here's an example of it in use. There are various other impairments. You can get to the strings at the combiner box, and that's where you normally measure. This is an example of a shaded array and what kind of IV curve. You know, it's supposed to be a nice, clean IV curve, and you can see that shade caused quite a mess there. Here are some of the other bad things that can happen over time to modules that are either not manufactured correctly or damaged in some way. So what are some of the trends? A lot of public policy is still very important.
That's happening all over in different countries, different states. There's lots of pressure on cost, and so we're not only getting that cost pressure on the modules, but also on the whole balance of system. More trends, more financing options. More than half of the systems now installed in residential are third-party owned. Well, what does that mean? The person who put it on their house doesn't own the system. It's either leased or they're buying the power from that system. So some big cigar-chomping bureaucrat is owning that system and making money off of that system by getting the tax credit for it, by being able to claim any of the incentives for it, and then selling you the power. Oh, by the way, they'll be able to sell that power to you for cheaper than your normal utility. So it's a benefit. It's a win-win, as long as they can make that business model work. And that is what's really accelerating adoption of solar in the United States right now. We're also getting a lot of utility projects. You saw how a lot of that utility business kind of came out of nowhere in the last 2 years. They're really starting to expand, driven primarily by that renewable portfolio standards in the states. Utility projects are always subject to approval. You know, even the snakes have rights, I think, is what we're learning. And the desert is not necessarily a completely barren place. But we're trying to make, I think the Department of Energy has done an admirable job of trying to site big solar projects in places that make sense. As far as jobs go, you know, there's a lot of opportunities. There's over 100,000 jobs currently in the solar marketplace, many more than that in the U.S., and many more than that in the renewable energy field. But what I would say is that it's not necessarily solar jobs. These are jobs like, you know, engineering technology or finance or marketing, or all the functions are the disciplines that are the traditional disciplines getting hired into the solar marketplace. So being able to get a job in solar doesn't necessarily mean just learning about solar. It means being able to be really good at something that solar companies will value. And lots of opportunities and consulting, retrofits, advocacy, and lots of startup organizations like Solmetric, but lots of others. There's more opportunity in the Bay Area right now, the South Bay, than there is in Sonoma County, but there is opportunity in Sonoma and Marin County as well. So if you want to get into it, you can't get discouraged if you don't get something your first try, but there are opportunities for learning, job shadowing, volunteering. There's some organizations that do a lot of solar work. You can get to know, network, and do a lot of things that way. Internships or whatever are great opportunities to do that. How to engage with the solar energy industry? Reading, there are some great magazines. In fact, I did a little cleanup at my office, and I wanted to give you guys the benefit of that. These are magazines that are freely available for you to take. You can pass them around and take one and enjoy it, keep it, recycle it if you don't want it. There are lots of really good ones. Solar Pro is one of my favorites. SolarProfessional.com. And another idea is to do some web surfing. RenewableEnergyWorld.com is one of my favorites. It covers the whole renewable energy. It has industry. It has a solar section, so it really focuses on solar. It gives you all the news and lots of background and good information. The Department of Energy has this Energy Efficiency and Renewable Energy, EERE. energy.gov. It's an outstanding resource. Just great news and ongoing reference information. That's where a lot of the information, like that Sunshot Initiative, you can find out all about what's going on with that in there. Go Solar California, for those California, what's going on in California specifically, what installations are being done, what are the policies, the drivers. That's where we always go to find information about the California. The website is gosolarcalifornia.com.
And if you do LinkedIn, I know probably a lot of you do Facebook, but LinkedIn is a better deal, I think, for solar. There are groups in LinkedIn. You go to groups and you search and you type in solar, and there are probably a couple hundred groups that you can follow and really learn a lot. You have a question, you just type it in, and somebody with time on their hands gives you a really professional, nice answer, and you get a discussion going. This is one of my favorites, which has thousands of people in it. It's called Solar Professionals PV and Thermal, and a lot of interesting discussion. I don't have time to read that all the time, but if I did, I'd learn a lot. Lastly, there's some local initiatives too. There's an organization called Solar Sonoma County that's a nonprofit that advocates for solar in Sonoma County and is responsible for networking all the installers community together and trying to advocate to the community locally. There's a new effort also. California law has a new rule that says that you can compete with your utility. And so it's called Community Choice Aggregation, or CCA. Marin County currently has a CCA program in place. Sonoma County is working toward getting one. And that means you could really see renewable energy facilities that would really be able to feed the grid, not just what they use on an annual basis, but as much as they want. And so you'd be creating a local market. So this is like the ultimate buy local campaign, which is an exciting future possibility as well. So a lot's happening. This is my final slide. I thought you might enjoy it.